Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Listening for America, Inside the Great American Songbook from Gershwin to Sondheim, by Rob Kapilow, narrated by Paul Woodson. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to examples present in the print and ebook formats of the book, as well as at listeningforamerica.net. Songs make history, and history makes songs. Irving Berlin. Preface. I cannot imagine a more unlikely book for me to write than this one. When I began my career at the age of 24 as the conductor of the Yale Symphony Orchestra and an assistant professor of music at Yale, my sole focus was conducting, performing, and teaching the core repertoire of classical music. Though I grew up loving Broadway musicals and could play practically every show tune I had ever heard on the piano, and would do so for anyone whom I could force to listen, for the 6 years I spent teaching and conducting at Yale, classical music was my life. In 1981, however, I was fortunate enough to become the conductor of the Tony Award-winning musical Nine. The thrill of conducting a live Broadway show with spectacular performers, superb pit musicians, and sold-out audiences was electrifying. Unlike my experiences in the concert hall, I felt an immediate connection with the audience, who clearly had a far greater understanding of Broadway's musical language than they did of Beethoven's. It was exhilarating. I realized how much I wanted to create the same kind of connection between classical music and its audience that I felt on Broadway, so I started a decade-long series of programs on NPR's Performance Today, called What Makes It Great. Each week I took the radio audience deep inside a short segment of music, often no more than a few measures, to help them hear what made it tick and what made it great. I wanted listeners to notice all of the rich details that might normally fly right by them. I wanted them to learn the language of classical music, one measure and one great piece at a time. I gradually expanded these radio programs into live, full-length performances in concert halls around the country. Each evening explored a single piece of classical music through discussion and demonstration, with the hope that listeners would hear the music's richness with new ears. One of the most ardent supporters of these programs was Lincoln Center's Great Performers series, and after several years of 6 classical presentations a season, the producers of their American Songbook series approached me about doing something similar with Broadway repertoire. Though I had adored the music all my life, I had never thought to look closely to see what made it great. But after listening to the songs of composers like Gershwin, Porter, Kern, and Arlen as if they were written by Schubert, I was stunned. Not just by how superbly crafted they were, but by how much I had missed in songs that I had known by heart since I was 12 years old. I was sure that, like me, audiences were missing just as much in this music as they were in Beethoven symphonies. As I began hosting What Makes It Great programs that looked closely, word by word, chord by chord, and measure by measure, at 4 or 5 songs of Gershwin or Kern, I discovered that audiences were as amazed by the sophistication of these songs as I was. For the next decade, alongside the classical What Makes It Great programs I was performing, the books and CDs on classical music I was writing and recording, and the new classical pieces I was composing, I chose one major Broadway composer to focus on each season. I analyzed hundreds of that composer's songs in order to create a single evening-length program on their music. 1 year I focused on Gershwin, followed by a year on Berlin, then Porter, Kern, Arlen, Rodgers, Bernstein, and Sondheim. In addition to immersing myself in each composer's music, I delved into their biographies, and each year the scope of my research widened. As I began to investigate cultural and historical context as well, I saw how deeply the American Songbook reflected, often in not immediately apparent ways, the times in which it evolved. Combining a close-focus musical reading with a wide-angled historical point of view brought classic songs like Over the Rainbow or Let's Do It to life as if they were brand new. Like dusty old master paintings that had suddenly been cleansed of years of dirt and grime. Audiences seemed to be as amazed as I was to meet these great songs again as if for the first time, both as extraordinary music and as striking reflections of their contemporary worlds. In writing this book, I have chosen to explore 16 songs by 8 of the greatest Broadway songwriters, from Kern to Sondheim, 14 from Broadway shows, and 2 from film musicals. Obviously, with so many songs to choose from, 20 more books could be written using different and equally great songs from each composer. I have chosen ones that speak most directly to me, and ones that I feel can most deeply benefit from a close musical reading while also being put into some larger cultural context. When Irving Berlin's White Christmas became a symbol of American values for homesick GIs during World War II, Berlin explained that songs make history, and history makes songs. Focusing on the intersection between history and music, looking at these songs as both extraordinary musical compositions as well as deeply meaningful reflections of an evolving America finding its voice, is at the heart of this book. A large portion of the music I will explore comes from a period that is often referred to as the Golden Age of the Broadway musical, roughly the years from the 1920s through the 1950s. The age of Kern, Berlin, Porter, Gershwin, Arlen, and Rodgers. Though this might seem to suggest a uniform, Edenic, static musical era, the period was actually bursting with dynamism. Much like America itself, Broadway was being invented moment by moment, song by song, scene by scene, show by show. As America emerged out of Europe's shadow and onto the world stage after World War I, the country tried to find an artistic voice of its own, and the Broadway musical was one of the first places this voice emerged. Painters, architects, writers, and composers were all listening for America, for the country's shape, texture, look, and sound, for its stories and its voice. And if we look at the songs of its greatest theater composers from the right angle, we too can listen for America inventing its identity as the country responded to the mind-boggling transformations of the Roaring Twenties, the Depression, World War II, and the post-war and Cold War years. In a discussion of her book, Draw Your Weapons, author Sarah Centillis compares her approach to writing to that of Fred Wilson's 1992 art exhibit, Mining the Museum, in which he provocatively put disparate objects, like a fine silver pitcher and a goblet, in a display case, alongside a set of slaves' shackles. Centillis says that, like Wilson's exhibit, her book tried to put pieces together that you wouldn't otherwise put together, as an invitation to think, and not a polemic. Similarly, in my book, I juxtapose the biography of the real Annie Oakley and Frank Butler with the version presented in Annie Get Your Gun, the reality of Depression-era America with the version presented in Gershwin's Girl Crazy, the advertisements of 1920s girly magazines with the envelope pushing morality of Cole Porter, and the actual facts about Puerto Rican gangs in 1950s New York City with West Side Story as an invitation to think and not a polemic. Each chapter is an attempt to put pieces together that you wouldn't otherwise. To listen for America as it was being created out of the imaginations of these extraordinary songwriters. It is my hope that in examining these 8 composers and 16 songs through both ends of the telescope, so to speak, zooming in to focus closely on music and zooming out to a broader cultural perspective, that they will emerge as dazzlingly new for you as they have for me. These songs tell us about America then, but also about all of us now. They sing about our hopes and dreams, our longing for love, and the pain of loss. Faulkner says, The past is never dead. It's not even past. I hope that this book takes these classic songs out of a safe, comfortable, golden age past and makes them as vibrantly alive as they were when their creators and the country were inventing who we are, when they were all listening for America. A note on technology and audience. For centuries, an author of a book on music had only two equally problematic choices. If a book included musical notation, it eliminated readers without the training to read the notation, but excluding musical notation made any detailed discussion impossible. Something like writing a book about painting without pictures. Today, thanks to new technology, this is happily no longer the case. Though there are many musical examples in this book, absolutely no knowledge of music whatsoever is necessary to read it. ListeningForAmerica.net provides recordings of every example synced to a moving scroll bar that lets you know exactly where you are. Comments and descriptions are written right onto the music so that you can hear and understand precisely what is happening as it occurs. I have also tried to avoid using confusing jargon. However, in order to make the book equally interesting for musicians or people with significant musical training, I have put more detailed technical explanations in footnotes or endnotes so as not to interfere with the narrative for the general reader. It is my hope that this book can be enjoyed by a casual listener with no prior musical knowledge, as well as a musical theater aficionado with extensive musical background. In the end, all you have to do is listen. Prologue. Nothing comes from nothing. Richard Rodgers wrote two new songs for the 1965 film version of The Sound of Music, I Have Confidence, which the young nun Maria, Julie Andrews, sings to convince herself she's ready to serve as governess to the Von Trapp children, and Something Good. Maria, unable to cope with her love for Captain Von Trapp, Christopher Plummer, leaves the family under the advice of the jealous Baroness Elsa Schrader, Eleanor Parker. Upon Maria's return to the convent, Mother Abbess learns that she is trying to escape her problems rather than face them, and encourages her to find a life beyond the walls of the abbey. Maria is heartbroken to learn that the captain is going to marry the Baroness, but when it becomes clear that Maria is the one he loves, the Baroness gracefully ends the engagement. Astonished by her good fortune, Maria tries to imagine what she must have done to be worthy of such a man. She concludes that, since nothing comes from nothing, and nothing ever could, their love could only be the result of some moment in her life when she must have done something good. These simple words, nothing comes from nothing, are of course a fundamental truth of all history, and represent one of the overarching themes of this book. Although we begin with music of the 1920s, a decade that saw America looking for an identity that could both reflect and distract from the unnerving realities of a bewildering post-war world, everything occurs within a context. As radically new as the music of the Roaring Twenties was, it didn't come from nothing. We should therefore start with a quick overview of the something that came before it. The theatrical forms of the 19th and early 20th centuries, as well as the African-American influences that helped to shape America's evolving musical voice. For those who want to skip this overview and dive right into the Great American Songbook, the heart of the book, you may jump to chapter 1 and refer back to the prologue as needed. Minstrel shows. We must respect the past, remembering that once it was all that was humanly possible, wrote Spanish-born American philosopher George Santayana in 1940. But parts of the past are easier to respect than others. There are some eras that require almost superhuman amounts of historical empathy, moments when it seems impossible to believe that we weren't morally capable of better. There is probably no greater error in the study of history than to bring the perspective of the present to the world of the past. But the appalling racism of white America during the 18th and 19th centuries is almost impossible to understand from a morally neutral point of view. Yet, however distasteful and shockingly racist it might seem for white men to cork up, that is, use the burnt cork from a wine bottle to blacken their faces before performing in minstrel shows, it represented an enormously popular phenomenon and helped pave the way for much of what was to come in vaudeville and musical theater. For nearly a half century, from the 1840s to the 1890s, minstrel shows were the most popular form of entertainment in America. They began with performances at the Bowery Theater in New York City during the 1842-43 season by a group of white entertainers known as Dan Emmett's Virginia Minstrels. Although men had been performing in blackface for many years, including Thomas Dartmouth Rice's famous impersonation of Jim Crow, the Virginia Minstrels were the first group to create a full-length evening of entertainment where white Northerners in blackface depicted Southern black plantation life through songs, dances, and skits. The idealized version of plantation life imagined in minstrel shows, in which happy black slaves loved their masters and spent their time singing, dancing, and joking, of course bore absolutely no resemblance to reality. Many white Northerners, however, had no other contact with black reality, and the offensive caricatures of foot-shuffling, eye-rolling, illiterate, uppity, happy-go-lucky darkies would last perniciously well into the 20th century. Shortly after Emmett created the Virginia Minstrels, E.P. Christie launched the Christie Minstrels, which quickly became the most popular troupe in the country, and gave the minstrel show its three-part structure. The action centered around Mr. Interlocutor, a pompous master of ceremonies, and his two endmen, Mr. Bones and Mr. Tambo, who provided comic interruptions and verbal repartee that anticipated many later comic duos like Laurel and Hardy, Abbott and Costello, and the Smothers Brothers. After a set of musical numbers interspersed with comic exchanges, the second part, called the Olio, was essentially a miniature variety show filled with songs and novelty acts that could include everything from acrobats, jugglers, and dogs, to dancers, monologues, or even someone playing tuned water glasses. The third part usually involved a plantation-based skit mixing songs, dance, and dialogue, and sometimes a parody lecture on a topic of the day. A Negro lecture on locomotives, for example, was an early feature of the Emmett repertoire, followed by a walk-around, during which the cast would hold hands, sing, and dance the cakewalk. An elaborate, high-stepping dance that by the 1880s had replaced the waltz as America's favorite dance. In 1859, Emmett wrote his most famous song, Dixie, for the Bryant Minstrels' walk-around, and it eventually became an unofficial anthem for the Confederacy during the Civil War. Though everything about the minstrel show was unquestionably racist, looking at the origins of the cakewalk gives us a sense of the complexity and subtlety of the relationship between blacks and whites in the minstrel tradition. The dance form actually began with slaves peeking through their masters' ballroom windows to watch them dance their marches, polkas, and waltzes. To make fun of the way they looked, the slaves imitated and exaggerated their masters' movements. This mimicry eventually became its own dance, the cakewalk. Their white masters then watched the slaves dancing and were so entertained that they started to copy their slaves' movements, not realizing they were copying a dance that was a parody of themselves. Whites, in effect, were imitating blacks who were imitating whites. As ironic as this was, it was only the first strand of minstrelsy's complex web of influence. Blacks, having seen whites' blackface imitation of them, thought they could do better. As the 19th century progressed, blacks started putting together their own minstrel troupes. But the only way whites would permit them on stage, they didn't want to see actual black skin, was if they corked up. This led to black men in blackface in black minstrel shows imitating what white men in blackface were doing in white minstrel shows, thereby perpetuating their own demeaning stereotypes and creating an absurd situation where blacks in blackface were imitating whites in blackface who were themselves imitating blacks who were imitating whites. At heart, these minstrel shows allowed white northerners who had no contact with black people to reinforce their sense that they were fundamentally different from and inferior to whites. The version of blacks that they saw represented by minstrel shows allowed whites to dismiss all blacks as the uneducated, lazy, sly, cowardly stereotypes they saw on stage, and it would take years to alter these images in any significant way. Though the musical instruments commonly used in minstrel shows, banjo, fiddle, tambourine, and bones, castanet-like clappers modeled on a plantation rhythm instrument made out of cow's ribs, did have some connection to life on a southern plantation, the music itself did not. Audiences might have thought they were listening to America, but in fact they were listening to Europe. Nearly all of the music heard in minstrel shows was based in some way on European or European-derived music. Stephen Foster, 1826 to 1864, the most famous composer of the minstrel show tradition, wrote for the Christie Minstrels for much of his short life. The first American composer to make his living solely from composing, Foster wrote songs and dance music that became a kind of American folk music. In spite of Foster's iconic American status, his music was influenced by Scottish and Irish dances, British ballads, Italian opera, German lieder, as well as by European parlor songs and folk songs. The themes, lyrics, and sentiments were American, the instrumentation in his minstrel show music was African American, but the musical roots and influences were European. As Foster's career illustrates, though the minstrel shows were profoundly racist, they had an undeniably positive side as well. Because of their enormous popularity and wide geographical appeal, they were pivotal in creating and promoting a popular repertoire of American-themed songs for America's first national audience. Minstrel shows went wherever there was a railroad station, and troops brought their music with them to far-flung locales in a way that had previously been unimaginable. On a practical, commercial level, minstrelsy also developed the basic procedures and techniques necessary to produce, promote, and tour that would become the central foundation of vaudeville and big-time American show business. Finally, and most ironically, a racist genre based on demeaning the entire African-American race offered thousands of African-Americans the opportunity to become singers, dancers, songwriters, and comedians at a time when those opportunities were reserved exclusively for whites. After the Civil War, freed slaves put on blackface, formed their own minstrel companies, and were able to make a living and somehow find a creative outlet within a belittling, demeaning genre. Eventually, this would lead to original music and shows written and composed by blacks, and the emergence of a black voice at the heart of 20th century popular music. Vaudeville. From the 1880s until the end of the 1920s, when radio and movies with sound captured the public's fancy, vaudeville, from the French voix de ville, or voice of the city, was probably the most popular form of entertainment for most Americans. It offered something for everyone. Shows included an enormous variety of short, unrelated acts, clearly derived from the olio portion of the minstrel shows, ranging from jugglers, magicians, animals, and acrobats, to dancers, comedians, dramatic recitations, and singers. A typical show, or bill as they were called, would feature about a dozen different performances, repeating several times a day for about a week before moving on to a new town. Having some kind of unusual talent was the key to success in vaudeville, and a really fantastic short act could travel for years. One of the most unusual acts was Haji Ali, the amazing regurgitator, who swallowed objects like watermelon seeds, coins, and peach pits, and then regurgitated them one by one on request from his audience. Because no single performer had to sustain an audience's interest for more than 10 minutes, vaudeville became a training ground where performers could practice their craft and develop their talent. Many of Broadway's biggest stars, performers like George M. Cohan, Al Jolson, Bill Bojangles Robinson, and Danny Kaye, got their starts in vaudeville. Historians generally credit the beginning of vaudeville to Tony Pastor, who opened his legendary vaudeville house in New York City on 14th Street in 1881. Pastor's idea was to create a kind of variety entertainment that middle-class families could attend with their children. A clean show that would be a step above the vulgar entertainment seen in saloons and burlesque houses at the time. A clear sense of the theatrical environment of the times and the new role Pastor wanted to fill can be seen in the famous banner above his theater door. It read, "Entertainment clean enough for women and children," and promised that there would be no drinking, smoking, or swearing by the performers. Most important, pistols were to be checked at the door. Pastor's preferred form of entertainment quickly caught on, and at the end of the 19th century, before recordings and radio entered the picture, vaudeville was the primary showcase for a songwriter's talents. Songwriters and publishers would convince leading vaudeville performers to sing their songs, and in turn, performers would come to publishers and songwriters looking for fresh material. The entire popular music industry, theater owners, performers, composers, and music publishers, worked together to create hits that would benefit them all. Their hope was that an audience member would hear a song he liked in a vaudeville show, purchase the sheet music at a music store, and play it on the piano for his friends at home, thereby expanding the reach of the song, the performer, the show, and the theater. By the turn of the century, promoters had bought or built nationwide chains of vaudeville theaters, and by the time of World War I, there were more than 2,000 vaudeville theaters stretching across the country. This provided an unprecedented degree of stability for performers, who could now sign a contract for an entire year of employment on a given vaudeville circuit. There were white vaudeville circuits and black vaudeville circuits, the Theater Owners Booking Association, or the Chitlin Circuit. And some white circuits even allowed for a black act as well, particularly those employing black children. Vaudeville often provided an escape from the horrific working conditions in urban 19th century sweatshops, and for child stars like George M. Cohan and Eddie Cantor, who started performing at an early age, the theater offered a far more attractive alternative, financially and socially, to the lives they would otherwise have been forced to lead. Silent films, radio, and finally talking pictures put an end to vaudeville, but long before it actually died, it had already largely been subsumed and replaced by another important form, Irving Berlin's favorite, the review. Reviews. Until Rodgers and Hammerstein changed the basic template of musical theater in the 1940s and 50s, reviews were one of the most popular theatrical forms on Broadway. Reviews made no attempt to integrate their songs into an ongoing plot, though occasionally there might be some kind of overriding theme to unify the evening. This made it easy for performers to shuttle back and forth between Broadway reviews and vaudeville, since, like vaudeville, each performance in a review was fundamentally a self-contained act. This also made reviews far easier for producers to assemble than book musicals. Without the constraints of plot, character development, or unity of tone, it was easy to change the order of songs or even to substitute other songs at a moment's notice. A particularly generous investor could even be rewarded for his financial assistance with a song for his aspiring actress, girlfriend, or mistress. It was newspaper magnate William Randolph Hearst who convinced Florence Ziegfeld to give Marion Davies, an unknown chorus girl at the time, a role in Ziegfeld's Follies. A review might have several different composers, with new ones brought in if the original songs didn't work. Because of this, reviews provided a crucial form of entry into the theatrical world for inexperienced songwriters not yet ready to write a full-length musical. They offered many young songwriters their first chance to get a song into a show. And a single successful song, interpolated in a high-profile review, could launch an entire career. Perhaps equally important to songwriters, a review offered them the opportunity to create a song with no ties to any particular character or situation. A song that could stand on its own as an independent work and be sung outside the context of the show in any situation whatsoever. During the 1920s, nearly 120 different reviews opened on Broadway. Irving Berlin created a series of music box reviews for his own music box theater from 1921 to 1924. The dancer George White started his George White's Scandals in 1919, using a single composer for each of his 13 yearly presentations. Earl Carroll produced 11 editions of his titillating Earl Carroll's Vanities, which featured almost completely nude showgirls in probably the raciest of all the Broadway reviews. All black reviews, like The Blackbirds, brought some of the most important black talent of the era to Broadway. Rodgers and Hart got their start in a 1925 review, The Garrick Gaieties, which gave them their first hit song, Manhattan. But the most important reviews of them all were the legendary reviews of Florence Ziegfeld, The Ziegfeld Follies. Florence Ziegfeld's Follies, which ran annually from 1907 to 1927, raised the form of the review to its highest and most exquisite level. His extravagant reviews had the most elaborate costumes, the most stunning sets, the most beautiful women, the most gifted comedians, the finest dancers, and the most expensive acts in show business. Inspired by the Parisian Folie Bergère, but actually named after a New York newspaper column called Follies of the Day, Ziegfeld's Follies set the standard for theatrical glamour on Broadway. Though he had no actual knowledge or skill as a writer, composer, designer, or director, Ziegfeld had superb taste, an uncanny sense of what made a production work, an obsessive focus on detail, an innate feel for what his audiences wanted, and a phenomenal gift for publicity. One of his first clients was the German strongman Eugen Zando, whom Ziegfeld brought to the 1892 Chicago World's Fair, touting him as the world's most perfectly proportioned male. Business was weak until Ziegfeld tricked a prominent Chicago socialite into touching Zando's bicep and having the photograph circulated in the Chicago newspapers. He also managed to convince New York audiences that his wife, Anna Held, a Hungarian Jew, was a quintessential French beauty who bathed daily in milk. After the milkman brought a libel suit against her for claiming he supplied her with sour milk, Ziegfeld used the publicity to save her first show, a parlor match. In addition to his gifts for publicity and spectacle, he had vision and courage, hiring the brilliant comedian Burt Williams in 1910 to become the first black man to co-star on Broadway with white performers. Ziegfeld's business card referred to him as impresario extraordinaire, and in many ways, he created the template for the modern superstar producer. The list of performers he hired for the various Follies productions included nearly every star of the era: Marilyn Miller, Eddie Cantor, Fanny Brice, Nora Bayes, Billy Burke, Will Rogers, W.C. Fields, Ann Pennington, and Sophie Tucker. Ziegfeld described his mission as glorifying the American girl, but perhaps a more accurate description would be inventing the American girl. At a time when magazines like the Ladies' Home Journal were setting new standards for what Americans' homes should look like, how they should dress, and what they should read, Ziegfeld was setting a new standard of female sexuality and creating an image of a refined ideal of female beauty that would last for years to come. Ziegfeld's fall was as spectacular as his rise. His fortune was nearly wiped out by the stock market crash of 1929, and his health soon began to deteriorate. Several final projects failed dismally, and he died in 1932, penniless and disgraced. But the theatrical form he had done so much to elevate and perfect, the review, would live long after his death and have a major impact on how songwriters, directors, and producers thought about their craft. Operetta. Before World War I, the theater scene in America was incredibly diverse, with a wide variety of musical presentations vying for different kinds of audiences. There were vaudeville houses all over the country, while on Broadway there were revues, musicals with plots, though interpolated songs often rendered these plots superfluous, musicals with little or no story whatsoever, and operettas. Before America began finding its own voice, it adopted one from Europe, inspired by the comic operettas of Offenbach, Gilbert and Sullivan, Lehár, and Johann Strauss. Many of these were brought over intact, translated or lightly adapted, but homegrown imitations quickly followed. Victor Herbert, the dean of American operetta, wrote more than 40. For the first two decades of the 20th century, operetta was unquestionably one of America's most popular forms of musical theater. Nearly everything about these European operettas, their music, lyrics, settings, performers, and orchestrations, was antithetical to the newly emerging American voice. Their plots tended to take place in non-American settings. Exotic European locations, fictitious countries, or romanticized pasts, and involved non-American characters, kings, princes, duchesses, gypsy girls, and the like. The subject matter and the language of dialogue and lyrics was the opposite of colloquial American English, filled with romantic, highly sentimental diction, like these lines from Lehár's popular 1905 operetta, The Merry Widow. "The night is romantic and I am alone. In vain through my window the moonlight is thrown. Oh, Velia, my Velia." Oh yes, that's the tune. The song of the shepherd who cried for the moon. Characters spoke in a language filled with words like evermore, nigh, and betide, and the lyrical, lushly romantic music was filled with European-style waltzes and marches. The string-dominated orchestra invariably included a harp, and the performers were almost always classically trained singers, as opposed to American musical comedy singers like George M. Cohan, who made up for his lack of musical training with enormous charisma and communicative ability. At the beginning of the 20th century, most of the imported operettas and the models for American imitations came from England or France. But the phenomenal success of Franz Lehár's The Merry Widow in the 1907-08 season, the show ran for 416 performances, shifted the focus to Vienna, inspiring a number of imitation Viennese operettas for the next 7 years. For audiences who found burlesque and vaudeville too lowbrow and the world of opera too highbrow, operetta offered the perfect middle ground. An escape into a sentimental world of romance and fantasy with relatively sophisticated music and language that was lighter, entertaining, and more immediately accessible than opera. Operetta's popularity, however, was abruptly brought to an end by the onset of World War I. Suddenly, saccharine, mawkish love stories about European princes and duchesses seemed grotesquely inappropriate, when so many people were being killed on the battlefield. And as Germany more and more became the hated enemy, banishing Viennese operettas and their clones from American theaters, became almost a patriotic act. In a behavior that eerily anticipated the Bush-era foolishness that turned French fries into freedom fries, World War I turned sauerkraut into liberty cabbage and hamburgers into liberty sandwiches. By 1917, European operettas had vanished from Broadway stages, giving Americans like Jerome Kern and Irving Berlin an opportunity to fill the void with authentically American productions in an authentically American idiom. But shortly after the armistice ending the war was finally signed, a wave of nostalgia for the imagined good old days, as well as a desire to escape from war and post-war realities, swept over the country. And operetta made a surprising comeback during the 1920s. European émigrés Rudolf Frimmel, who came to New York from Prague in 1906, and Sigmund Romberg, who arrived from Bucharest in 1909, composed a string of phenomenally successful operettas in the 1920s, often working with Oscar Hammerstein II on productions like Rose Marie, 1924, The Desert Song, 1925, and The New Moon, 1927-28. That these romantic throwbacks to a Eurocentric age could be so successful at the time that Kern, Gershwin, Berlin, and Rodgers and Hart were inventing an American voice, one expressly designed to reject everything operettas stood for, should serve as an important reminder that history is never neat and tidy. The simple stories we tell ourselves rarely do justice to the messiness of the real world. Ragtime. Though ragtime may have entered many people's consciousness with the phenomenal success of Irving Berlin's Alexander's Ragtime Band in 1911, Berlin never claimed that he was writing genuine ragtime. In fact, he said he never discovered what ragtime really was. Because the fluid borrowing of music was such an important feature of the black-white dialogue of the 20th century, precisely defining musical styles like ragtime, blues, jazz, swing, rhythm and blues, and rock and roll can be challenging, if not impossible. Though black pianists began playing ragtime in brothels and wherever they traveled in the 1890s, the idea began much earlier. Ragging referred to a particular way of performing a piece of music, altering and syncopating a pre-existing song. In a travelogue published in 1876, the Georgia-born poet Sidney Lanier remarked, "Syncopations are characteristic of Negro music. I have heard Negroes change a well-known melody by adroitly syncopating it so as to give it a bizarre effect scarcely imaginable." In the same way that 18th-century performers of Baroque music would elaborately decorate and ornament pre-existing pieces, black performers would rag pre-existing melodies. Taking an improvised tradition and freezing it in notated form is a practice as old as music itself. It can be seen in the development of Baroque and Javanese gamelan music, as well as ragtime, jazz, and blues. Bach's contemporaries complained that he stifled creativity by writing out all the ornaments and decorations in his music, leaving no room for performers to improvise. In a sense, that is what happened to ragtime as well. Once this kind of freely improvised ragging became a familiar sound, pieces began to be composed in a ragged style. Composers wrote syncopations and decorations into their music, rather than allowing performers to improvise them freely. But even after rags were published in sheet music form, professionals continued to improvise on, or fake, the pieces themselves, the origin of the term fake book, resulting in what was really an early form of jazz. Many Americans heard ragtime for the first time at the 1893 Chicago World's Fair. And by 1899, when Scott Joplin published his wildly popular Maple Leaf Rag, more than 100 piano rags had been published. By 1900, lyrics were being added to these ragtime pieces, and the largely racist, demeaning language of these new songs made them extremely popular with whites. In 1911, Irving Berlin's Alexander's Ragtime Band took a genre that had started in brothels and dives and made it respectable and stylish. In what would become a recurring phenomenon throughout the century, whites took music that started in the black community and disseminated it in a domesticated form, making it an essential component of mainstream America's musical voice. Ragtime brought with it a completely new kind of dancing as well. Before ragtime, the waltz, both as a dance and a kind of song, think Bicycle Built for Two or The Sidewalks of New York, dominated the musical landscape. Though the waltz had itself been risque when it replaced the minuet early in the 19th century, by 1900 it had become as old-fashioned as the minuet once was, and the difference between its smooth, romantic European gentility and the shocking American physicality of the ragtime dances coming out of the black community was nothing short of staggering. The Charleston, the Black Bottom, the Turkey Trot, and the Grizzly Bear were primal, sexual in a way that scandalized and excited not just those with Victorian inhibitions, but even modern New Yorkers. A New Jersey woman was given a 50-day prison sentence for dancing the turkey trot, and politicians and newspapers throughout the country railed against these dances' vulgarity, certain they would corrupt the nation's youth. But the power of the music was overwhelming, and it eventually overrode all inhibitions. This, too, began a pattern that would repeat throughout the century, in which nearly every popular style of music originating from the black community, ragtime, jazz, blues, bebop, swing, rock and roll, and rap, would initially be condemned by whites who feared it would corrupt their children, only to be embraced, appropriated, and ultimately assimilated into the mainstream. Blues. Scott Joplin's death in 1917 is often used as a convenient date to mark the end of the ragtime era, but by then, many of ragtime's essential musical features were already being absorbed into a new style, called jazz. At the same time, another great contribution of the black community, the blues, was also entering America's consciousness. Like ragtime and jazz, the blues, too, would be modified, domesticated, and ultimately absorbed into the musical language of the Broadway musical and American popular song. The blues began in the rural South and was brought north as part of the Great Migration, when a 500,000 African Americans moved to northern cities like New York, Chicago, and Detroit during and immediately after World War I. Historians generally put the total figures of the Great Migration at approximately 1.5 million for the first wave of migration from 1916 to 1940, and more than 6 million between 1916 and 1970. The roots of the blues were oral, but its spread to the culture at large really began when the music began to be notated, most famously by W.C. Handy, the so-called father of the blues, whose Memphis Blues of 1912 and St. Louis Blues of 1914 started a fad that inspired large numbers of songwriters to publish their own bluesy pieces. The appropriation of the blues by whites began quickly. The first jazz record ever made, The Livery Stable Blues, was produced by a white group, the Original Dixieland Jazz Band, in February 1917. Many other white imitations followed, like the Limehouse Blues and The Birth of the Blues, not to mention Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. And eventually, black versions of the blues were recorded as well. In 1920, Mamie Smith's first blues recording, Crazy Blues, convinced producers that there might be a market for what were then called race records, records made exclusively for blacks, but that were often bought by whites as well. Her recordings, along with those of other black women like Ma Rainey, helped spread the blues to white listeners throughout the 1920s. Aside from the simplicity of the basic 12-bar, 3-chord format, what drew songwriters and America to the blues was the power and authenticity of its expression. On the simplest level, the blues told the story of a black man or woman who had the blues. A woman like the woman in the St. Louis blues, who sings, "I hate to see that evening sun go down. I hate to see that evening sun go down. 'Cause my lovin' baby done left this town. I got those St. Louis blues, just as blue as I can be. Oh, my man's got a heart like a rock cast in the sea. Or else he wouldn't have gone so far from me." The blues was a wail, a lament, an outpouring of sadness that came straight from the heart. It told stories of trouble and pain in an honest, unsentimental, world-weary, often sexual way. And all the striking musical features of the blues that white songwriters ultimately appropriated for their own purposes, the shouts, the flattened blues notes, the bent pitches, slides, and vocal cries, grew directly out of a deep emotional heartache at the music's core. The blues brought a profoundly new kind of emotional expression and style of speech to popular music from a source that was utterly American in origin and completely independent of any musical or verbal association with Europe. Like ragtime, the blues was American, and it was the foundation for much of the popular music that would follow. Jazz. If Irving Berlin made ragtime respectable, Gershwin did the same for jazz. Howard Pollack's biography of Gershwin quotes the avant-garde composer Henry Cowell's witty 1931 description of jazz as "Negro minstrel music as interpreted by Tin Pan Alley New Yorkers of Hebrew origin." And though almost none of the music written by the composers in this book could legitimately be called jazz, the influence of jazz on the language of the popular song was immense. Gershwin, Arlen, and later Leonard Bernstein had considerable first-hand experience hearing great black jazz artists perform, but most white songwriters' knowledge of jazz was really only second or third hand. In spite of the fact that F. Scott Fitzgerald famously called the 1920s the Jazz Age, no one seemed able to agree on what that meant, or what was or wasn't real jazz. Like ragtime and blues, indefinite origins, blurred genre lines, and the mixing of different musical styles make any single definition of jazz nearly impossible. But there is no doubt that the jazz of black musicians helped give the Broadway musical a language and identity that was independent of Europe and authentically American. Though jazz originally grew up in New Orleans, out of a complex mixture of black spirituals, gospel songs, blues, ragtime, and marches, the same massive black migrations that brought the blues north and west around the time of World War I brought jazz along as well. According to jazz historians Hasse and Lathrop, the earliest officially authenticated use of the word jazz in print was in a San Francisco newspaper in 1913, and multiple spellings of the word, J-A-S, J-A-S-S, J-A-Z, or J-A-Z-Z, coexisted until 1918. Adding to the confusion, until the 1920s, many New Orleans musicians called what we today would refer to as early jazz ragtime. In yet another case of whites appropriating black musical culture, jazz first became widely known through the popular recordings of the aforementioned all-white original Dixieland jazz band, beginning in 1917. It was not until 1923, when King Oliver's Creole jazz band began to make their first recordings for Jeanette Records, followed by Louis Armstrong's legendary Hot 5 and Hot 7 recordings for OK Records from 1925 to 1928, that black jazz began to reach the general public. In another example of the fluid, complex black-white relationship of musical influence, King Oliver actually owned a large collection of the original Dixieland jazz band's recordings. Though King Oliver's and Armstrong's recordings, like those of Duke Ellington, Bessie Smith, and Jelly Roll Morton that followed, were originally considered race records and sold only in black markets, they eventually broke through to white markets as well. Initially, jazz spread through a combination of sheet music, player piano rolls, and the early recordings of the late teens and twenties. However, after an initial reluctance to air jazz due to its supposed inappropriateness, it was the explosion of radio as a mass medium in the middle of the 1920s that ultimately brought jazz to listeners everywhere and made it a truly national phenomenon. For many white Americans, hearing Duke Ellington's performances at the Cotton Club broadcast on the radio was their first exposure to both black performers and authentic jazz. The 1920s also took jazz overseas to an enthusiastic European audience, and during the swing era of the 1930s, jazz would enjoy perhaps its widest mainstream exposure. The swing craze would bring performers and audiences of all races together in numbers that remained unequaled before the arrival of rock and roll. The era would also see the transformation of many earlier popular songs into jazz standards, giving them a new and different life, and challenging our fundamental conception of what constitutes a song. Though jazz had an enormous influence on popular songs, their histories are fundamentally different, and the gap between popular music and genuine jazz grew larger and larger as time passed. But in the 1920s, jazz provided the characteristic sound of the era, and the two forms came as close together as at any moment in their histories. Jazz musicians played in Broadway pit orchestras, and Broadway composers wrote music for black performers at the Cotton Club. Jazz's defining instrument, the saxophone, replaced the European sound of the violin as the dominating sound of the popular music orchestra. It was sensuous, earthy, and enormously emotional, and it changed the entire expression and sound of American orchestras. Jazz said no to an old-world European sense of romance, and yes to the new world of the flappers, bathtub gin, and the roaring twenties. Though no one might have been able to precisely define just what jazz was, white bandleader Paul Whiteman called it the folk music of the machine age, its sound was in the air. Its spirit spread throughout the culture. If something was a little dull or behind the times, the antidote was to jazz it up a bit. It was a noun, it was a verb, it was everywhere. And though most of the Broadway music of the 1920s and 30s was more jazzy than jazz, it was inescapably shaped by this brash, vital, energetic sound sweeping the country and emerging as a defining element of America's newly invented voice. 1. Inventing America. Jerome Kern's Can't Help Lovin' That Man. The 1946 film version of Jerome Kern's life, Till the Clouds Roll By, is essentially told in flashback form. It begins on the opening night of Showboat, Kern's legendary 1927 musical, with a magnificent, if truncated, Reader's Digest version of the premiere. After recounting his pre-Showboat career for nearly 2 hours, the flashback segment of the film ends with a melodramatic scene in which Kern, lost in thought, walks along the banks of the Mississippi River in Memphis, Tennessee. As the camera focuses more and more closely on Kern's face, he says with increasing intensity and emotion, "I walked along the river that night, with the river wind in my face, and the taste of it on my lips, and I stood there listening." A tiny scrap of Old Man River is heard murkily in the low brass. The music of "You and me, we sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain." A sudden excitement, thrilling for me, listening to the sound of a river that makes its way right through the heart of America. And the voice of that river, with the laughter and the tears and the joys and sorrows and the hopes of all America's people, The musical fragment starts to clarify itself and rises in pitch, louder now, as if the beginnings of an idea are forming in Kern's imagination. Suddenly, a majestic showboat, with smoke billowing out its smokestacks, floats into the frame. A riverboat that looks suspiciously like Captain Andy's cotton blossom on the cover of Edna Ferber's novel, Showboat. As the music rises, still louder and higher, trumpets and full orchestra enter triumphantly, with the opening phrase of Old Man River underlining Kern's final speech, as if the idea for Showboat came from the river itself. As the music fades, the two-hour flashback ends, and the film returns us to reality. Kern, played by Robert Walker, in a taxicab with a driver named Joe, wittily the name of the character who sings Old Man River, is on the way to Showboat's opening night party at the Waldorf Astoria. The scene in which the idea for the show comes to Kern as he walks along the banks of the Mississippi River and happens to see a riverboat pass by has a satisfying, if highly melodramatic, logic. Its intensity feels appropriately climactic as it concludes one of the film's central dramatic arcs. One of the principal characters in the film is Jim Hessler, Kern's lifelong mentor and musical companion. During the flashback, we see Kern as a beginning songwriter come to Hessler's home asking for advice. Though Hessler is initially dismissive of the young composer, a performance of one of his early songs convinces Hessler that Kern has the potential to become a famous songwriter. The two become close friends, and Kern becomes Uncle Jerry to Hessler's young daughter, Sally. After the appropriate period of trials and tribulations that every young composer must undergo in a film biography, Kern becomes a success, while Sally turns into an aspiring actress and singer. Kern, who has been helping her career along, gives her her first big break, the title song in his new musical, Sunny. But when the producer assigns the song to Marilyn Miller instead, Sally is heartbroken, quits the musical, and ends all contact with both her father and Kern. Shortly afterward, Hessler dies of heart failure, and in a poignant deathbed scene, Kern promises to search for Sally, reestablish contact, and make sure that she's all right. Hessler's death, as well as his guilt over the break with Sally, plunges Kern into a deep depression, and he loses all will to compose. Oscar Hammerstein II visits and brings along Edna Ferber's novel, Showboat, which he enthusiastically suggests they turn into a musical. But Kern is unable to even feign interest. Time passes. Kern continues to be lost in despair, until one day he learns that Sally is singing in a nightclub in Memphis. The club elite. He immediately travels to Memphis, makes peace with Sally backstage, and with his deathbed pledge to his friend fulfilled, his depression lifts. He leaves the nightclub and walks along the Mississippi River. With his personal problems resolved, his creativity is restored, and the idea for Old Man River and Showboat rises triumphantly out of the moment and the Mississippi River itself. Though the scene is enormously satisfying emotionally, unfortunately, every aspect of it, and for that matter, nearly everything else in the film, is completely fictional. Jim Hessler, Kern's mentor, musical comrade, and constant companion throughout the film, never existed, though in some small way he might have been modeled on the Broadway arranger Frank Sadler, a close friend and frequent orchestrator of Kern's shows. Hessler's daughter Sally also never existed, while Kern's actual daughter Betty receives no mention in the film whatsoever. But most important, the entire scene on the banks of the Mississippi River, the supposed genesis of Old Man River and Showboat, is complete invention. Neither Kern nor Oscar Hammerstein II ever actually saw the Mississippi River, nor did Edna Ferber, who wrote the novel that the musical is based on. She wrote the book while in Spain at the Gulf Hotel, and Kern wrote the music to this quintessential depiction of early American life on the banks of the Mississippi River from his studio in Bronxville, New York. It's ultimately not that surprising that this romanticized view of life on the Mississippi River was created by three people who never actually saw it. The South has continually been the source of reinvention, both for actual Southerners, like Margaret Mitchell, who's gone with the wind invented a Civil War South that existed only in her imagination, as well as for Northerners like George Gershwin and Irving Caesar, who created their banjo-strumming, mammy-waiting-Dixie in Swanee, having never been farther south than the southern tip of Manhattan. For a country with no ancient history, this kind of mythical southern past has often served as something like an American, pastoral version of a before-the-fall Garden of Eden. It takes an enormous amount of artistic self-confidence to create works like Gone with the Wind, Swanee, Appalachian Spring, Billy the Kid, Showboat, Oklahoma, and White Christmas purely out of one's imagination, yet it is exactly this kind of self-confidence that was at the heart of America's ability to invent its own musical voice in the 20th century. That this voice developed at this particular moment in America's history was no accident. The emergence of music that sounded distinctly American, particularly in the realm of the Broadway musical, was deeply connected to historical, political, economic, social, cultural, and technological developments occurring in America at the time. Placing the music of this era in this kind of rich context allows us to listen to this music and our history in new and surprising ways. Like so many of the songwriters of the Great American Songbook, Jerome Kern was Jewish. But unlike most of them, he was neither poor nor born on the Lower East Side of New York City. His father, Henry Kern, was a prosperous German business owner, and the family was part of a kind of new Jewish-American aristocracy. The Germanic culture of Kern's parents would remain a lifelong influence, and Kern's music had a refined elegance and old-world gentility that clearly distinguished it from the brash, upbeat, hard-edged sound of Gershwin and Irving Berlin. In many ways, Kern, a patrician New York Jew, seems like an unlikely candidate to be the motivating force behind the first truly successful, racially integrated musical on Broadway, not to mention a musical that deals with racial bigotry and includes black performers who play non-stereotypical, three-dimensional characters. Unlike Berlin and Gershwin, whose careers were launched in meteoric fashion by the spectacular success of a single song, Alexander's Ragtime Band for Berlin and Swanee for Gershwin, Kern found his voice slowly. Though he had more formal training than many of his fellow songwriters, with studies in theory, harmony, counterpoint, and piano at the New York College of Music and in Germany, like so many other aspiring songwriters, he began his career as an accompanist and song plugger, a pianist or singer hired by a music publisher to demonstrate, or plug, a publisher's songs to performers, managers, and producers. At the time, America's voice in the musical theater was largely a European one, with foreign plays and operettas dominating the musical landscape throughout the first two decades of the 20th century. The comic operettas of Gilbert and Sullivan and Offenbach served as models for countless imported and Americanized versions, and it was in this world that Kern first found his voice. Unlike true operettas, which typically took place in exotic European locales in a fantasy realm of kings, princes, duchesses, and gypsy girls, British musicals at the turn of the century were concocted out of a mixture of Gilbert and Sullivan, continental operettas, and vaudeville. They replaced the operetta's world of dukes and duchesses with a more realistic, recognizable world of shop owners and chorus girls. For almost a decade, Kern frustratingly interpolated nearly 100 songs into 30 of these musicals with only modest success. In a sense, it was World War I that gave both Kern and America an opportunity to find their voices. They Didn't Believe Me, from The Girl from Utah, gave Kern his first big hit in 1914. Yet nothing in this song's lovely mixture of old-world European sophistication and American innocence, or the famous princess theater shows of the next 5 years, nor even in his hit shows of the early 1920s like Sally and Sonny, gave any indication of what was to come in Showboat. Having spent many of his formative years as a songwriter in London, Kern had quickly become a master at mimicking the language of contemporary English musicals. Though this British influence would always remain a part of his voice, like many American artists in the teens and twenties, Kern was interested in finding an American voice. Having initially been founded as a British colony, our earliest cultural identity was predominantly British. Still visible in the English spelling Americans tend to use when referring to musical theater as opposed to theater. But once independence had been declared, we were cast adrift with no traditions or body of culture that had been handed down from generation to generation for centuries. Though there was, of course, a rich, ancient, indigenous Native American culture, it largely existed in its own parallel universe, and little attempt was made to integrate it into mainstream American artistic life. What culture did exist was largely a mixture of fragments of diverse immigrant cultures that the continual waves of new settlers kept bringing to America with them, and of course African American culture. In the absence of a centuries-old musical heritage, African American music became perhaps America's most vital, authentic, homegrown musical source. For decades prior to World War I, white America created mainstream versions of African American forms of cultural expression, beginning with minstrel shows. As the 20th century progressed and composers began searching for an American voice that could serve as an alternative to the Eurocentric operettas and musicals that dominated Broadway stages, multiple forms of black music became key source material. Black religious music, spirituals, hymns, and gospel songs, as well as blues, ragtime, and jazz, all became important, largely uncredited influences on the emerging American musical. Showboat, broadly, and Can't Help Lovin' That Man in particular, are inextricably bound up with African American music and culture, as refracted through a northern white American's eyes. Showboat was not only the greatest achievement of Kern's theatrical career, it was and is a landmark in the history of the American musical theater. In much the same way that the birth of Jesus can divide chronological time into B.C. and A.D., the timeline of musical theater has traditionally been divided into before Showboat and after Showboat. The show radically widened the dramatic range of the Broadway musical, with a storyline that dealt with serious issues like miscegenation, alcoholism, racial injustice, compulsive gambling, and desertion. Its plot was utterly unlike the light escapist plots of other contemporary musicals, and its approach to character development was more like that of a novel or play. Musically speaking, Showboat was an extraordinary mixture of an operetta and a musical. Kern's score managed to mix a wide variety of American vernacular styles, ranging from 19th-century minstrel shows, historical pastiches, and operetta-like waltzes and ballads, to blues, work songs, jazz, and 1920s popular songs. The show was not only dramatically and musically groundbreaking, it was culturally groundbreaking as well, as it was the first musical to present a black and white chorus singing together on a Broadway stage. In short, Showboat's seriousness of tone and expanded sense of dramatic possibility created a precedent that ultimately allowed other revolutionary musicals to follow. Race is a central theme in Showboat, in ways that were startling for its time. It featured major black characters, and racial issues were central to the plot as well as to the music. Can't Help Lovin' That Man actually turns on the relationship between black music and white music, The published sheet music begins with an unusual tempo marking that directly reflects Kern's and other white composers' appropriation of black music. Mixing Italian and English words, the marking reads tempo di blues, that is, tempo of the blues. Europe meets America. Both Hammerstein's lyrics and Kern's music attempt to imitate black vernaculars. From the very beginning, the showboat sheet music listed the song titles in dialect as Ole Man River and Can't Help Lovin' Dat Man. But the theater programs and theater critics used more correct spellings, Old Man River and Can't Help Lovin' That Man. In a sense, the question of whom this music belongs to is what the song and plot are all about. Can't Help Lovin' That Man not only begins in the tempo di blues, it actually begins with a white composer's version of the 12-bar blues. The 12-bar blues began as a southern black form, a wail, a complaint, which was then appropriated, notated, and made mainstream by white musicians. It is the foundation for a great deal of early rock and roll. Elvis Presley's Hound Dog is a great example. Though the form eventually became richly decorated and varied, at heart the 12-bar blues uses only three simple chords in a fixed sequence that you might call home, away, and farther away. In musical terms, we call them 1, 4, and 5, because they're based on the first, fourth, and fifth degrees of the scale. I've sketched the basic pattern in example 1.1, located in the print version of this book. Four measures of 1, home, two measures of 4, away, two measures of 1, home, two measures of 5, farther away, and then two measures of 1, home. In short, 1-1-1-1-4-4-1-1-5-5-1-1. A home-centered form of 12 measures with two brief journeys away. Home, away, home, farther away, home. In rock and roll, the two measures of 5 are often replaced by one measure of 5 and one measure of 4 for variety, as in measures 9 and 10 of example 1.1. Like so many blues singers throughout history, Julie Laverne, the leading lady aboard the Cotton Blossom showboat, is complaining about love while somehow accepting the inevitability of the pain it brings. Magnolia Hawks, an aspiring singer and 18-year-old daughter of the boat's owner, Captain Andy Hawks, has just met and instantly fallen in love with a handsome riverboat gambler, Gaylord Ravenal. Julie warns her of the dangers of falling for this kind of riverboat stranger, to which Magnolia replies that if she discovered he was no good, she would simply stop loving him. Julie tells her that it's not so simple to stop loving someone. No matter what happens, and tragic events will in fact soon happen, Julie will always love her husband, Steve Baker. She simply can't help loving that man of mine. The key to Can't Help Lovin' That Man is the fact that, with one tiny variation, its verse is a perfect 12-bar blues. Since the basic form starts with four bars of the same chord, Kern, like many composers, decorates the pattern in the second measure for variety. But it's not only the harmonic pattern that comes directly from the blues. The melody also uses classic blues notes, flatted notes, borrowed directly from rural southern blues. Without blues notes, the opening phrase would sound bland and generic. But it's the blues notes on sis and miss that make it great. They particularize the relationship between Julie and her sister and show the pain and mixed emotions aroused by her mister. Underneath the vocal line, the piano gives the music warmth, the unique mixture of love and pain at the heart of the blues, showing how Julie feels about her Mr. Man, her husband, and the troop's leading man. In example 1.4a of the print version, I've stripped out the blues notes. As a result, the accompaniment lacks all feeling, even though the melody is unchanged. It's Kern's dissonances in the piano part that give the music its emotional power. Details are everything. The difference between a good song and a great song is both enormous and infinitesimal. It's hundreds of small, inspired choices made by a songwriter and lyricist, note by note, word by word, rhythm by rhythm, chord by chord. Kern, for example, could easily have kept the voice blandly in the low register for "There Ain't No Reason Why I Should Love Dat," but the leaps up on "reason" and "love dat," plus the blues note on "dat," are what make it great and show what loving that man feels like. Blues notes are the key to the ending as well. Once again, compare my cheery, upbeat, homogenized version without blues notes to Kern's poignant, resigned version with blues notes. It's not only Kern's music that draws from African-American sources, but Hammerstein's lyrics as well. Replacing the flowery language of European operetta with African-American vernacular speech, or white versions of that speech, became a common technique for songwriters searching for an authentic American voice, and Hammerstein's use of imitation black speech, "There ain't no reason why I should love dat man," can also be found in Arlen's Stormy Weather, Gershwin's Porgy and Bess, and countless other songs of the period. But what is crucial to understand here is that this imitation of black musical and verbal language is central to the plot of the entire song. Julie is actually part black, but because she is so light-skinned, she has managed to pass as white. Eventually, her secret is uncovered, and since her mixed-race marriage to Steve was illegal in the South, she has to leave the Cotton Blossom, an event that starts her on a long downward spiral toward ruin. However, at this point in the show, no one knows her racial status, and when she sings the song, Queenie, the black cook on the ship, recognizes it as a song that only black women sing, and is surprised that Julie, a white woman, knows it. It is the fact that Julie is singing a 12-bar blues with blues notes and vernacular African-American lyrics that gives her away. However, Julie is part black and part white, and the song is as mixed race as Julie. The verse, as we have just seen, comes from the black world of the blues, but the chorus that follows comes straight out of the white world of musical theater. It is an absolutely textbook 32-bar Broadway song form that begins with the classic 8-bar A section in example 1.7. Rhythm brings the music to life. Compare the stodgy, inert feel of my square, unsyncopated version with Kern's, which brilliantly syncopates only the two key action verbs in the phrase, swim and fly. Also notice the perfect matching of music and lyrics. The melody has the simplicity of an axiom. It starts with three repeated notes, leaps up to three repeated notes, then returns to the opening three repeated notes. It has a kind of simple inevitability, as does the simple, straightforward, first-year theory textbook harmony, which is what the words are all about. Fish gotta swim and birds gotta fly. It's just the way things are. He then copies the two-measure idea lower to cement it in our ears, but notice the wonderfully dissonant dark chord under die in "I Got to Love One Man Till I Die." The punchline, along with its long melody notes, feels almost like a hymn. And with traditional harmony, like the one I have supplied in example 1.10, that's exactly how it would have sounded. But listen to the way that Kern wrote "Lovin' Dat Man," with the only unusual chord in the phrase. In his hands, we feel just how strange and unexpected love can be. Following the standard 32-bar form, the music of the A section repeats with new words, and the B section manages to tell an entire story in only 8 measures. The first 4 bars are all about her man going away. When he goes away, that's a rainy day. But the last 4 are all about his return. And when he comes back, that day is fine. The sun will shine. The music depicts this journey in a direct and powerful way. As she anticipates her man's return, the music climbs up a scale, always moving by step, And then finally, when he returns on the word fine, the vocal line leaps for the only time in the entire phrase to the highest note of the entire song. And that note, his imagined return, gloriously brings out the sun and leads to the return of the opening music of the chorus. The song finishes with an exact repeat of the A section, which is rare. Even in a standard AABA 32-bar Broadway song like this one, there is usually some slight alteration for the conclusion, a melody that goes up and finishes on a high note, or some other kind of change at the end. But here, it is as if what she's telling is so timelessly true, so utterly and simply human, that it has an almost fable-like quality. This is how it is, and how it's always been. No alteration is needed. It's a simple universal truth. Can't help loving that man of mine. Inventing America. Since the invention of photography, and later of cinema, we have become more and more able to convincingly portray reality. Yet, ironically, as our ability to portray reality has increased, our interest in imaginative versions of reality seems to have diminished. Today we live in an era that is obsessed with authenticity and historical accuracy in its depictions of the past. If a 21st-century musical were being written about life on a 19th-century Mississippi River showboat, the process would surely begin with extensive historical research on the part of the creative team. No effort would be spared to make sure that every hemline, fish fork, set piece, linguistic accent, and dialect would be reproduced exactly as it was. Historians would be consulted, experts would advise, and the importance of historical accuracy would be taken for granted. However, neither Kern nor Hammerstein were remotely concerned with historical accuracy. They felt no more need to visit the Mississippi River at the heart of Showboat than Jack Norworth and Albert von Tilzer felt the need to see a baseball game before writing Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Like so many writers, artists, composers, and poets, Kern and Hammerstein were inventing America, and they invented it purely out of their imaginations. They took the source material wherever they could find it and modified it without the slightest concern for authenticity. Hammerstein adapted Ferber's novel with astonishing freedom. In the book, for example, Steve and Julie disappear after being forced to leave the Cotton Blossom. But in the musical, Julie returns in Act Two to play a pivotal role in helping Magnolia's career get started in Chicago. Gaylord Ravenal, the compulsive riverboat gambler who marries and deserts Magnolia.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.